All right. Oh, yeah. By the way, if it isn't sticking out like an entirely sore thumb, this is the new studio that we're working with here. I know it's a work in progress, but I'm here for a very specific reason. And it's because last night I was here downtown covering the protest outside of the federal courthouse. And I stayed as it went from peaceful to violent, which after several hours did seem to happen in an instant. But because of that reporting, I'll be doing this show here in this conference room slash studio, news studio, because of COVID. Just in case I were down there and I were to get infected with COVID, I don't want to come back here and give it to all my other coworkers. So I'm kind of quarantined up here in the building so no one else gets sick. And I hope that the dip in production value is worth the exchange for journalism, which I do think it is. Now, some of you were calling for this and have been for a while. I got a message last week, and I've gotten several just like it. They said, send Dan Hagerty down to the nightly lawful assembly and provide a non-fearful, honest viewpoint of the people. So that's exactly what we did. And I can say that the lawful assembly and the unlawful one are two very different experiences. So let's start with mine from the beginning. And with that, I do need to preface, keep this in mind. This is the very first time that I went down and covered these protests in person. So this is one vantage point from one person of one night of 60 consecutive nights of protests in our city. And I can say that the one I went to started very peacefully. I know that is a trigger word for a lot of you, but it's the truth. People were friendly, they were hopeful, they were handing out water, the speakers sounded like hippies, not soldiers. And I didn't sense any nervous energy or aggression from people, not even for the people who looked like they were there ready for a fight. Then again, that may be because they were used to fighting by now. Now, I went right up to the fence, right? That's where we've seen all the action every night. That's where the fighting starts. And I wanted to see that transition from the peaceful rally to the tear gas in the fires. And that's exactly what I saw. And here's how it played out for me. Around 11 p.m., about half of the crowd had left. The lights and the lasers came out. They started shining on the courthouse and lighting up all those broken glass windows on the building from night after night of rocks and BBs and fireworks. Next came the actual fireworks, the same kind that the kids love on the 4th of July. I mean, they're loud, they're bright, they make you jump, but they have burned officers and protesters when they go off too close. This all went on for about 30 minutes, the lights and the fireworks and all that kind of stuff. And the feds did nothing. They didn't do anything. I mean, nothing at all. It seemed to me for a while that it was almost like no one was home. I actually started to think maybe tonight would end without any real fireworks. Until people started climbing the fence. First, a few people straddled the top of the fence and got the crowd chanting. Then, someone hopped the fence entirely and started yelling profanities at the building before climbing back into the crowd. People got braver and braver. You see here, these are two men who hopped over the fence and started running around inside, causing the crowd to cheer. The federal officers did not like this. They did not like it at all. And it was after that, it was the first time that we heard from them. See, one of their concerns, of course, has been fires burning too close to the building, or even worse, violent protesters getting inside. So after that, they got onto the loudspeakers and they gave a warning. But people kept climbing. And then they declared an unlawful assembly. They said it just one time. Honestly, it was hard to even hear given all the chanting that was going on, but there was no doubt that they meant it, though you couldn't really tell right away. In fact, there was kind of a lull. Nothing happened for a moment. People started talking to each other. I pulled out my camera and started messing with some of the buttons on there when all of a sudden it started quickly, like a flash, literally the gas canisters came flying into the crowd. I wasn't recording at the time, honestly. I was stunned into some type of stupor that you don't really want to admit after a moment like that. You wish you were more composed. But one of the canisters landed right at my feet. Someone ran over and kicked it away. People screamed to put on a gas mask. I scrambled for mine. I'd practiced putting it on before I went out there, but in the moment, in the heat of it all, it was a lot different. The gas makes your face feel hot and flush, your eyes well up, your lungs tighten. It's kind of like taking a hit of a cigarette for the very first time in your life. Your body rejects it violently, and everyone was panicking. I didn't see really even where the canisters came from, if you can believe it. I assumed they came from the doors of the courthouse, but by the time the smoke cleared, the officers were nowhere to be seen, and the doors were closed. Now, the protesters, without a gas mask or without goggles, they went running for cover. They were in the back of the park coughing. I saw some of them throwing up. But the protesters who were dressed for battle barely budged. A few dozen people in the crowd are protected from head to toe. They have on gas masks and helmets, body armor and padding, heavy coats and gloves, shields made from thick wood and thick plastic. And honestly, my very first reaction right there experiencing it was that the feds took that situation from a 2 to a 10. And if you were out there chanting in a t-shirt and a COVID mask, it would certainly feel that way. If you got hit with pepper spray and pepper balls and tear gas, it would be like a traumatic assault. But for the people in that protective gear, that gas is only a cloud in front of their vision, and the pepper balls barely sting, or so I'm told. Those people didn't run. They formed ranks and they shrugged it off. Now, this all happened around midnight, and the whole song and dance begun. They went back and forth 4 hours. Each time, each side would become more and more aggressive. Eventually, rioters started small fires behind the fence, and that's when the officers decided to enter the crowd and clear the streets up close and personal. This next video isn't mine. It was shot by an independent journalist named Corey Elia, and it shows what the end of the night looked like.
Did you just really fire at your own guy?
Sweep around, there's more. I'm on this. If you want to move, I'm on this.
Okay, so what's my take? After one night, 60 days in, if you ask me, everyone's concerns about what they're seeing downtown are true on both sides. Do some of the protesters provoke the federal officers to act? Absolutely. Do the feds respond with extreme measures that affect the entire crowd of people, most of whom haven't broken a single law? Yes to that too. Did I find that last video that we showed you disturbing? Yes, I did. It's jarring enough to capture the whole world's attention, and they're all looking at Portland right now, and it needs to stop. But how? That video was shot around 3:30 in the morning, 4 hours into slowly escalating violence. I honestly did wonder what would happen. What would have happened if nobody would have climbed those fences, if they wouldn't have jumped over them and run around, if the crowd would have stuck to chanting and blocking streets. But I'm not quite ready to have an opinion on that one just after one night. But I do know this, something has to give. I definitely feel more qualified talking about this now after going down and seeing it with my own eyes, but you don't have to see it in person to know that if we continue like this, something tragic is bound to happen.